Hello, my name is Cecilia McGough, and I'm an astronomy and astrophysics major here at Penn State, and the founder and president of the Penn State Pulsar Search Collaboratory. In high school, I was lucky enough to have co-discovered a pulsar through the Pulsar Search Collaboratory. A pulsar is a super dense neutron star that emits dipole electromagnetic radiation. So, like, basically think of a star much, much larger than our sun, blowing away its outer layers, leaving behind a dense core. That core could be our pulsar. This discovery opened some doors for me, such as helping represent the United States in the International Space Olympics in Russia, and also being a Virginia Aerospace Science and Technology Scholar. I know what you guys must be thinking, what a nerd. Nerd alert! Well, for the longest time, this nerd had a secret that I was too scared and too embarrassed to tell anyone. That secret is that I have schizophrenia. But what is schizophrenia? It's important to think of schizophrenia sort of as an umbrella-like diagnosis. NAMI shows these different symptoms as ways you could diagnose having schizophrenia, such as delusions and hallucinations being sort of the hallmark type of characteristics. But it's very important to know that a person could have schizophrenia and not have delusions and not hallucinate. Each person's story with schizophrenia is unique to their own. Today, I'm going to be talking about my story with schizophrenia. It's been thought of that I've had schizophrenia all of my life, but it became very prevalent my junior year of high school and then just snowballed into college. February of 2014, my freshman year of college, my life changed when I tried to take my own life through suicide. Why, you ask? Because my life had become a waking nightmare. The following images have been edited using Microsoft Artistic Effects because they are just too triggering for me. At this time, I had started hallucinating. I started seeing, hearing, and feeling things that weren't there. Everywhere that I went, I was followed around by a clown that looked very similar to the Stephen King's adaptation of It. Everywhere that I went, he'll be giggling, taunting me, poking me, and sometimes even biting me. I would also hallucinate spiders, sometimes little spiders, and these are actually the most obtrusive sometimes because we see little spiders in real life, so sometimes this is the only time I ever have difficulty discerning whether it's a hallucination or real life. I'm very good at knowing when I'm hallucinating, and I know that it's a chemical imbalance inside of my head. I don't give these hallucinations even names. I also hallucinate also giant spiders, though. One spider in particular comes to mind. It was rather large, leathery skin, black legs, and yellow body. And no voice ever came out of its mouth. However, when it moved its legs, the creaking of the legs sounded like young children laughing. It was very disturbing. But it started becoming unbearable when I started hallucinating this girl. She looked sort of like in the movie The Ring. The thing with her is she was able to continue on conversations with herself and would know exactly what to say and when to say to chip away at my insecurities. But worse was she would also carry a knife around with her and she would stab me, sometimes in the face. This made taking tests, quizzes, and doing homework in general extremely difficult to impossible when I was in college. Sometimes I wouldn't even be able to see the paper in front of my face because I was hallucinating too much. I don't usually speak so openly about my hallucinations because people usually look at me in fear after I tell them what I see. But the thing is, I'm not much different than the rest of you. We all see, hear, and feel things when we're dreaming. I'm just someone who cannot turn off my nightmares, even when I'm awake. I've been hallucinating now, obtrusively, for about over 4 years. So I've gotten very good at just pretending I'm not seeing what I'm seeing or ignoring them. But I have triggers, such as seeing the color red is very triggering for me. I don't know if you guys noticed this or not, but they changed the carpet that I'm on. They changed it to a black carpet instead of red. I sort of laugh at my life a bit, like a dark comedy, because of course, the only color combination that I have issues with is red and white. What is Ted's colors? Really, people. But I have issue with those colors because those are the colors that the clown has, red hair and white skin. And how I'm able to ignore him is I just don't look at him, but I'm able to know where that hallucination is in my peripheral vision because of the bright colors of red and white. But you never know that I'm hallucinating. The clown is actually in the audience today, and you would never know. On a lighter note, who's looking forward to the Oscars? Hands up? Anyone? Oh, yeah, I knew you guys would be interested in the Oscars. Well, if there were nominations for people just acting normal in everyday life, people who have schizophrenia would definitely be nominated as well. When I first became open about having schizophrenia, it was a shock to even the people closest to me. It took me 8 months, 8 months after my suicide attempt to finally get the treatment that I needed. I didn't even have the diagnosis of schizophrenia. And because of that, what kept me from getting help were conversations like these. I remember very distinctly within that time on the phone with my mother. I would tell my mom, "Mom, I'm sick. I'm seeing things that aren't there. I need medicine. I need to talk to a doctor." Her response, "No, no, no, no. You can't tell anyone about this. This can't be on our medical history. Think of your sisters. Think of your sisters' futures. People are going to think that you're crazy. People are going to think you're dangerous, and you won't be able to get a job." What I say to that now is don't let anyone convince you to not get medical help. It's not worth it. It is your choice, and it is also your right. Getting medical help was the best decision that I've ever made, and I am confident that I would not be here today if I didn't get the proper medical help. This led into my first hospitalization. I've been in the psych ward 4 times now within the past 2 years, two-ish years. But I still was not open about having schizophrenia until my second hospitalization because the police were involved. One evening, I realized I needed to check myself back in the hospital because I needed some changes in my medication. So I admitted myself into the emergency room. I talked to the doctors. They said, "Okay, let's fix the meds. You can stay here overnight." It was all good. After the hospital, the brief one-night hospital stay, I came back to my dorm here at Penn State, and to very concerned roommates, which I understand why they were concerned. If I was in their shoes, I would have been concerned as well. But also the RA and a can-help person. We all talked, and we decided that I needed to have another psych ward stay. And I was okay on going. I wasn't at all refusing, and I was willing to go. But what happened next was inexcusable. They brought police officers into my dorm room in front of my roommates. They patted me down, and I had to convince them not to put handcuffs on me. They then escorted me into a police car that was parked on the road next to one of our most common dining commons, Redifer, where friends were passing by and seeing me put into a police car. By that time, when I came back, the cat was out of the bag. People knew something was up. so I had to set the story straight. I opened up about my schizophrenia through a blog, but I posted all my blog posts on Facebook, and I was amazed about how much support that was out there. And I also realized that there were so many other people just like me. I was actually amazed. A few of my friends opened up to me that they had schizophrenia. Now, I am dedicated to be a mental health advocate. I'm not going to wallow in self-pity about my diagnosis. Instead, I'm going to use it as a common denominator so it could help other people who have schizophrenia. And I am not going to rest until anyone who has schizophrenia worldwide is not afraid to say the words, "I have schizophrenia." Because it's okay to have schizophrenia. It really is. Because 1.1% of the world's population over the age of 18 has some sort of form of schizophrenia. That is 51 million people worldwide and 2.4 million people in the United States alone. But there's a problem. Because 1 out of 10 people who have schizophrenia take their own life through suicide. Another 4 out of 10 attempt suicide at least once. I fall into that statistic. You would think that there would already be a nonprofit focused on empowering college students who have schizophrenia, especially since the peak age to have a schizophrenic break is early adulthood, the same age range as a typical college student. But there isn't. There is no nonprofit in the entire United States focused on that. And a general nonprofit focused on mental health in general is not enough, because even in the mental health community, schizophrenia is shied away from because it makes people feel uncomfortable. That is why I have decided to found the nonprofit Students with Schizophrenia, where we will empower college students and get them the resources that they need so they could stay in college and be successful. Because you could be successful and also have schizophrenia. We need to change the face of schizophrenia because the representation currently is inaccurate. Don't let anyone tell you that you can't have a mental illness and also not be mentally strong. You are strong, you are brave, you are a warrior. Unfortunately, this nonprofit is too late for some. Since I've become open about having schizophrenia, I am asked to come into different classrooms here at Penn State and talk to the class about my experience having schizophrenia. One class stands out in particular. Earlier in the semester, one of the students opened up to the class that she had schizophrenia. I commend her for her bravery. However, by the time that I came and talked to that class, she had taken her own life through suicide. We were too late for her. I was too late for her. Here at Penn State, we have to make an example to the world, because this is not just happening here at Penn State, it's happening globally. But here at Penn State, we have to show that we are here for our students, we are talking about mental health, and we are not afraid to talk about schizophrenia. My name is Cecilia McGough. I have schizophrenia. And I am not a monster. Thank you.